Well, good morning, everyone. I think we'll get the day started. I want to welcome everybody to the Citywide Department of Family Medicine retreat. The title of our retreat, as you can see on the screen, is Best Practices in Integrating Care, Family Physicians and Hospital Systems. And I'll explain a little bit more about that in a moment. We have a retreat in the Citywide Department every couple of years to focus on quality of care issues in family medicine and in the system in general. And so this is our choice of topic for this year. You know, we always want the best quality of care for our patients who are mostly community-based patients, since we're family physicians. But our patients are also patients at the hospital and integrate within the wider hospital system. And we know that transitions between community and hospital back to community care are sometimes where there are gaps and this can affect the quality of care. And this is why we wanted to focus on this area for today's retreat. How do we best manage communications and transitions between community and hospital-based systems? I want to, before we get started, I want to just run through the, well, first of all, here's the learning objectives for today, which are printed on your handout, and you'll see those in your packages. I want to just thank Sheena Blazing from the Citywide Department of Family Medicine for coordinating the events today and making sure that everything runs smoothly. Sheena always does an excellent job coordinating our events, as many of you know, and we thank her for that. I also want to thank our IT staff here at in the Department of Family Medicine, Charlie Mahagan and Michelle Stubnia for their work, and David Kressis from the Schulich IT, who gets our IT up and going. Today's session is being recorded, so I'd like the speakers to please use a microphone at all times, and when there's questions coming from the audience, we do want to record those using a microphone as well, so we'll be passing a mic to you to ask your questions. The agenda for the day is listed here. We're going to have a panel discussion starting at about 9:30, after Scott Mackay from our department has given his presentation introducing the issues. Each of the panelists is going to have 10 to 15 minutes to speak, and then there's going to be questions following all of the panelists' presentations. That'll be followed by a break, and then we're going to do what's called a roving storm session. And each of you has been assigned to one particular area as a starting point. And there are going to be breakouts around the room. There are four of them. And each of our speakers is going to occupy one of those stations. And groups of four or five people will rotate between stations. But you'll all start at one. And you can tell where you're going to be starting based on the color of the dot on your name tag. That's just the starting point for you. Everybody is going to have a chance to rotate through all of the speaker sessions and a chance to interact with the speakers. The purpose of that roving storm session will be to try and focus on key issues where there are problems and where we need to try to make some corrections and try to come up with solutions. Several of us from the Citywide Department will be there to try and capture those ideas, and then we're going to give you that in summary form towards the end of the session. We'll tell you a little bit more about that as we go along. So I hope everybody enjoys the day. The topic is really interesting and really informative and really has a chance to improve the quality of care for our patients and the work life for family physicians, specialists, and hospitals as well. To start off the day, I'd like to invite Robin Walker to come up and give us some greetings. He is the Integrated Vice President of Medical Affairs and Medical Education for both hospitals, London Health Sciences Center and St. Joe's Healthcare. Dr. Walker.
So good morning, everyone, and it is indeed a pleasure to be here to bring you one of your welcomes from the hospitals. I won't take very much time because I know you've got a packed agenda, but I thought I would just start off by telling you about a couple of things that we're doing that are pertinent to your theme today. I think it's self-evident to everyone in this room, whether you're on hospital staff or in the community or both, as many of you of course are, that much as we try to improve both the primary care system and the hospital system, we have a long way to go to bring them together. Having been raised, as it were, in the British health system, I've seen a different way of doing it. And although their hospitals still leave a lot to be desired, the level of integration between community health, primary care, public health, and the hospitals is certainly several levels above what we have achieved in our system. And my 93-year-old mother thanks them for that. So a couple of things that we're doing that are pertinent. First of all, let me talk to you a little bit about some of the changes we've made on the IT side of things, which are helping us develop a different level of integration. Many of you will be well aware of Hugo, a project in which Sarah and Tom were also very much involved. Hugo provided physicians with the wonderful opportunity to enter all our orders directly into the electronic health record, computerized provider order entry, something which probably many physicians do not thank us for. But that, together with electronic medication administration, electronic medication reconciliation, has resulted in a more than 30% decrease in drug errors across the 10 hospitals in southwestern Ontario that installed the system. Some hospitals, it's even greater. At St. Joseph's, it's about 40%. And wrong patient, wrong drug mismatches have been close to eliminated, not quite, but most of those that sneak through we've discovered are because there's an occasional person who has bypassed the system. So that's a huge improvement. But perhaps something that's more pertinent to many of you is the Connecting Southwest Ontario initiative, which is starting to provide a level of integration between community-based electronic health records and hospital electronic health records. The first step in that was Clinical Connect, which I can tell you is hugely popular with hospital physicians. And that starts to speak to how these tools can at least assist us in our attempts to integrate care between different types and levels of care. The other initiative I want to just mention in passing, and many of you will be aware of this, is an attempt on the behalf of the hospitals to try to find a way to better engage physicians in decision making and organization of the hospital. Many of us here are old enough to have lived through the various cycles when we had the medical model and then we had the anything but the medical model. We lived through an era when the leadership of hospitals particularly, but the health system in general, shifted away from physicians. And now we're in the interesting situation in Ontario of having both the minister and deputy minister are both physicians. And of course, the number of CEOs of hospitals who are physicians is once again ballooning. We have Julian Kernahan at St. Joseph's here. And there was actually an interesting study just published. It was based on US data, but showing that hospitals with physician CEOs generally had much higher quality outcomes as well as better physician engagement outcomes. So a group of physicians, Sarah and Mark McLeod as the MAC chairs, myself and Margaret Steele and Meetu Sen at Schulich, have been working with a number of other people on an initiative that's intended to better engage physicians in the work of the hospital. We're very, very early in this, even though we've been working for a year. And the first step has been meeting all the departments to get input. There was a meeting with your department just a week or two ago. It was my clinic day, so I couldn't attend, but I understand the discussion was tremendous. So you'll be hearing more about that, in particular on the St. Joseph's side. Sarah and I are now rounding quarterly with every chief to learn more about what's going on in every department and see how we can bring the hospital's leadership closer to those initiatives and to helping you. So those are just a couple of the things that are going on in the hospitals, which hopefully speak to you as well and speak to your theme for today. I will just mention this is my clinic day again, so my first patient is until 10, so I won't have to leave till about 9:30, but you will see me sneak out the back then, and that's the reason. So welcome once again on behalf of the London Hospitals, and thank you very much for all the work you do, both in the community and at the hospitals, to support our patients together. Thanks, Steve. Thanks, Ron.
Thanks very much, Robin, for your kind introduction. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sarah Jarmaine, who's the chair of the Medical Advisory Committee for St. Joseph's Healthcare and co-chair of the Joint Medical Advisory Committee. Sarah.
Thanks very much. All right, good morning. So this is really an exciting morning, and quality of medical care is really a passion of mine and something that I've been paying attention to for quite a long time. When I think about what's important to me in thinking about concepts around quality, I really like the work that comes out of the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, and particularly the work that Don Berwick led for many years in terms of looking at how do we achieve better care for the patient, so really paying attention to both quality of care and patient experience for those individuals. Better health for the population, so thinking about not only who's right in front of us, but who's waiting to see us, and then better value in terms of are we making the best use of the dollars that we have to try and manage the resources. So I try to use that as the frame for thinking about what's important in quality, and as we start to look at the issues, how do we frame it to really try to pay attention to all of those three areas. I think probably the biggest work that's come out of quality that helps us organize is the work that came out of the Institute of Medicine around the year 2000. And they really talked about the different domains that we need to be paying attention to. So is care safe? Is it effective? Is it patient-centered? Is it timely, efficient? And is it equitable? And I think we're starting to see more focus on the equitable side of things in terms of how do we actually meet the needs of disparate populations and look at diversity within healthcare. So as we sort of drill down to think about quality and safety in hospital, lots of work over the last decade to say what are the problems there. And the whole role of medical error, which now in studies has been listed as one of the top 10 causes of death in the U.S. And in an article a couple years ago, they challenged and said, you know, probably it could be looked at as the top 3 cause of death for individuals in the U.S. And lots of different factors tend to contribute to that. Part of it is we're human and we're going to make mistakes. So the need to look at the system as a whole and to say, have we got those checks and balances in place that allow us to catch errors before they happen, or to prevent the error before it happens, or to catch it before it actually arrives at the patient and to prevent that from actually causing harm. And one of the big areas that has been time after time identified as an issue is ineffective communication among healthcare professionals. It's one of the leading causes of medical error and patient harm. And the research suggests that particularly among physicians, this has a huge impact. And in fact, there was a report from the Joint Commission in the U.S. that talked about communication failures impacted over 70% of sentinel events in hospitals. So it's a huge issue. And I think that where we particularly see that is in the transitions and the handoffs, and particularly as you see patients come from the community into the hospital, change from service to service, or to head back to the community. Those tend to be the high-risk times that we haven't necessarily paid a lot of attention to. We've sort of hoped that, you know, good communication will just somehow happen on its own. And in the ever-increasing busyness of our lives with frequent challenges around distraction, I don't think we can do that anymore. There has been a growing research on the use of standardized communication tools, probably one of the ones that people are most familiar with, which has been used here in London, is SBAR. So looking at what's the situation that needs to be communicated, what's the background, what's the person's assessment, and what are they recommending needs to be done. And we've actually rolled that out within some of our nursing teams to try and help, particularly in the on-call circumstance, and have a structured approach for relaying information. There's been other interesting approaches, particularly for trainees, in terms of developing apps or more structured tools that really structures that process. And actually in April, at our medical advisory committee, we're going to have a presentation talking about some of the tools that have been piloted here in London and some of the literature behind it showing that. So I think really thinking about the theme today and, you know, how do you look at those transition points? How do you look at sort of key points of communication? And are there more structured approaches or standardized approaches that make a difference are huge. I think another big area that we need to be paying more attention to is the whole area of appropriateness. So as we look at that better value of the triple aim, it's saying, are we using our resources in the best way possible? And choosing wisely, Canada has been gaining a lot of traction. And I know in looking at some of the recommendations that the that family medicine has put forward, a lot of it is around screening tools and what are those right screening tools that really show the benefit, and what are those times that instead we need to be educating the patients to say, you know what, this is not going to make a difference. So I think that's a whole area that we're starting to pay more attention to. And in fact, one of the things that we've started this year is we've added a subcommittee of the MAC that's called the Diagnostic and Utilization Subcommittee. And the focus of that group is really to start to have those difficult conversations around, you know, how do we pull in that evidence? How do we start to look at the principles we want to follow? And how do we start to look at some standardization in terms of what is appropriate use of testing? And what's not, and as an two organizations, do we need to actually make some tough decisions around what we will support or not support? So growing area there. I think the other piece is that as we look to the U.S. and you know, in some of our healthcare funding, we're sort of falling 5 to 10 years. What, you know, started there seems to catch on here. So if we look at what's been really shifting in terms of the focus on a system as a whole and incentives for that system as a whole to look at quality. So as you look at some of the work that's happened around medical homes in the U.S. and accountable care organizations, you're starting to see attempts to really drive quality with financial incentives that aren't just targeted at a single service or a single organization, but actually across primary care, community care, and hospital-based care. And I think we're starting to see some early pilots of that happen in Ontario. The Health Links is one example where they sort of are focusing on those high utilizers of the system and can we be doing things differently. So I think that's another area we need to be getting out in front of and saying, are there some innovative ways that we can start to tackle that? And there may be opportunity for funding for those if we can bring those forward. I just wanted to end with talking a little bit about some of the structures that support quality within the hospital system, because I have to say that, number one, as a resident and even as a early psychiatrist, I didn't actually know what an MAC did. And so it was only as I sort of went further in my career and became involved with the Medical Advisory Committee, that I understood the role in terms of supporting medical care across the hospital system. So we have our MAC that meets jointly between the two organizations and has a number of different subcommittees which are really focused on different aspects of care. So whether it's the perioperative committee, whether it's looking at non-acute sites, emergency response, all of those different areas have a group of individuals that are doing that work on a day-to-day basis that are really trying to look at what are key metrics that we need to be paying attention to and what's the work plan to try and improve those. And all of those subcommittee chairs meet twice per year to really try and share issues, challenges, opportunities, and recommendations. And that's been a really helpful way of understanding the themes and understanding where we need to shift within the hospital. We also really look at learning from the mistakes that do happen. So any level 4 or 5 events, in other words, events that have either the potential for serious harm or serious harm to the patient, are reviewed. Some of those happen under the QCIPA legislation, so where the discussion is protected. But a lot of others are just part of a normal clinical review with the interdisciplinary team. And those summaries of those reviews and those recommendations are reviewed by what's called the Quality of Care Committee. So Robin and I sit on that committee along with the clinical VPs. And part of what we're looking at is one, has there been a robust enough discussion to really drill down and identify what were the learnings? And two, some accountability for spreading those recommendations. So there's some things that it's really a learning that's just relevant to that team, but there's others that we're starting to see themes that we need to say, how do we spread this information across? And we use structures like our Quality Council at St. Joe's for doing that. We use our leadership councils at the different sites for doing that. But one of the areas that I think we haven't had a good approach with is how do we get that information to the departments? So one of the things that I would like to leave you with for thinking about today is how do we do a better job in that bidirectional communication between some of the hospital quality structures and the work that you're doing within your department. So both in terms of us identifying issues we can communicate to you for spreading, and also for issues that you identify as up-and-coming things we need to be paying attention to. So I'll leave you with that to have some thoughts about.
Thank you very much, Sarah, and thank you again to Robin for your remarks and introducing and setting up the stage for the next part of the retreat, which is going to be our panel discussion. And first, I'd like to invite Dr. Scott Mackay to come to the stage. Scott is a family physician at the Byron Family Medical Center. He's the site chief for Victoria Hospital here in London, and he's also the associate chair of the academic department. Scott is going to give us an introduction to the issues that frame the retreat and leading into our panel discussion.
Thanks, Steve, for your introduction. Apologize to everyone for my croaky voice. I'm not actually sick. My son's hockey coaches, and we had a tournament on the weekend and made it to the finals. So five games in 3 days, and encouraging the kids to play their best has left my voice a little squawky. I'm really excited that we're having this opportunity to get together with academic physicians, community physicians, hospital representatives. Because this, I think, before I get in, I guess I have to do my disclosures, so I have no disclosures for this. There's no financial support, in-kind support, and I don't need to mitigate anything. So I'm really excited about the opportunity we have today. I've been asked to kind of be one of the setup people to try to bring up some of the issues, some of the things that we're going to talk about today. So I approached this presentation thinking, so what's the purpose? What's the purpose of why we're here? And so I said this is kind of the starting point And what's the purpose? So I wanted to speak a little bit to, you know, how do we come up with this idea? We live why this idea has come up, as primary care physicians and as hospital physicians as well. The patients we see are getting more complicated and more complex. They're being discharged to the community sooner. And there's a real need to have, information, flow to and from the hospital, in a timely manner so we can take care of our patients as best we can. And we can actually have the hospital-based physicians take care of our patients the best that they can. We see that resources in the healthcare system are becoming scarce, and they're being used differently. They're shifting things from a hospital to community. This is a time of change. So I think, the opportunity we have today is to really get ahead of this and get some ideas around, how can we do this better? What mistakes have we made in the past? And what, how can we build on these things to move forward? We thought long and hard about the speakers that we're going to have involved with you today. There's some common things that I hear from my colleagues and hear from my medical colleagues. So we wanted to make sure we tried to get a good breadth of speakers and resources brought into us to dialogue with us. I have involvement with a lot of the speakers. So Brenda and I worked on an ideas project looking at how we can get discharge summaries out to primary care faster. That really gave me an opportunity, actually, because I was working more on the hospital side of things for that project than in the community. And it really made me realize we haven't had this opportunity to have dialogue between internal medicine and family medicine. There was things that I heard when I was talking to the internists that I didn't know. And in turn, when I presented them, things that I saw from my side, they didn't realize the impact. So again, this is why we're here today. You may or may not know Adam Duclo and I were classmates, so we're longtime good friends. And we have many, many chats, on his beach in the summertime about how we can improve the communication between the eMERGE and between family docs. And again, this was the opportunity to bring that, from a beer on the beach to somewhere where we can actually, get some more input and move along. Gord's sometimes there too. He's down in port too. I was going to try to open it up a little bit and just see if there's any particular objectives that the audience wants. I'm cognizant of time. I really want to get to the meat of the presentation. So hopefully in the question and answer and the roving session, if there's things that, you really wanted to get out of today, then we will. So the other purpose, the real purpose of why we're here, it's about patients. We all really want the same thing. We want, to provide the best care for the patients that we serve. So I'm going to tell you just a story. Maybe we don't like cases, but we tend to do everything in case-based things. So I'm going to tell you about Mrs. F. This is a patient that I was involved in her care. So back in 2015, she was in hospital for a couple weeks. She had a myriad of diagnosis. Sort of the garden variety, family medicine, internal medicine patient, I'd say. She was discharged from her two week and a little bit to hospital stay on the 29th of the month. When you kind of look through the trail of things, the discharge summary was she was discharged on the 29th. The dictation was completed on the 30th, and it was transcribed on the 1st. Everything seemed to be, going according to plan. When you actually looked at the discharge summary, and these are some excerpts from it, there was five. I think there were six. I just consolidated a bit. There was 5 points. That were actually very clear, had a really good follow-up plan. Regarding leg edema, there were some instructions around medications and changes and monitoring parameters. Follow up with the family physician. Her liver enzymes had been off in the hospital. Family physician to continue to monitor that. Regarding new diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension, they recommended she be referred for a sleep study as an outpatient. They arranged for follow-up with internal medicine, and that was all in discharge summary. And there was some comments about the CCAC follow-up that was arranged. It was a very complete discharge summary. Lots of really good information about what the plan, transferring that information to the community, to the family doc, to the CCAC for internal medicine in terms of their role in the follow-up. Unfortunately, she got readmitted on the 4th, 5 days after her discharge. because her edema was worse, and she was just declining and couldn't cope at home. So I was actually involved in her as when I was covering for the hospital, it's for the subacute medicine. So I was on the hospital side of this. This is a patient that I got called to see. And so I found that discharge summary that was still sitting in the system, not authenticated. Hadn't been sent out to the family doctor, presumably CCAC, and sometimes they have access to Cerner now. You know, they didn't get to see the plan. CCAC hadn't been arranged in time. The family doctor didn't get the information. The patient wasn't clear that, you know, there was a follow-up planned with internal medicine that they maybe could have contacted the team instead of just ending up back in the emerge. I can only imagine that, you know, when this patient that was pretty complicated on paper, you know, showed up in the emerge, they said, well, this patient just left the hospital. You know, how did this happen? So it's frustrating for them, the internal medicine team, I'm sure that took the patient back as a readmission within 7 days. You know, there's lots of things here. And this is what, you know, I want us to build on for today. So there is some evidence, some studies that actually support, you know, some of these things. So this was an interesting study that I found. So this was a tertiary care teaching hospital in Australia. And they actually looked at more than 16,000 discharges from internal medicine. And looked at, you know, how many discharge summaries were done and was there any kind of relation to readmissions. So their study found about 1 in 5 patients never had a discharge summary done at all. They found that there was an increasing trend as the longer it took for the discharge summary to be done and get delivered to the primary care physicians, they were more likely to be readmitted. So patients that by 7 days didn't have a discharge summary, 79% increased rate of a 7-day readmission. And 37% increase in 28-day readmissions. The interesting thing they found was this was actually higher for younger patients, so that the trend didn't continue with age. So for patients under age 80, if they didn't have a discharge summary done by 7 days from hospital discharge, there was 127% increased chance they were going to be readmitted after 7 days. The other thing that they noted when they looked at the trends were that if there was no difference between a discharge summary being dictated at some point after 7 days and never having one at all. So that first 7 days having a discharge summary, you know, is clearly making a difference. So again, that's one thing that, you know, we've all experienced and the hospital re-experiences as readmissions. So something we need to work with. This was an interesting article where they actually talked to family doctors, primary care practitioners, and hospitalists about communication, about the hospital patients that they share. And there's some interesting findings in it that I just want to highlight. So there was things that were similar between the hospitalists they talked to and the family docs they talked to. You know, so they said, you know, some of the barriers they found to good communication were a lack of time, difficulty being able to reach the other clinicians, a lack of personal relationships with other clinicians, a lack of information feedback loops. And this is something that, you know, I think is actually a really key point. You know, we see a lot of things happen, but we, you know, sometimes I feel like there's no way to actually feed that information back and say, you know what, this was a problem. You know, how can we try to fix that? And I'm sure it happens on the other side as well, with the internal medicine physicians, the emergency physicians, you know, that they see things that, you know, they'd like to feed back to us, and there's no way to do that. Again, I think today is our opportunity. You know, in terms of some of the particular things, some of the hospitalists, you know, they had a lot of difficulty obtaining timely follow-up with primary care. So I think this is something that primary care needs to make sure we're able to do. When our patients get discharged, have timely follow-up. You know, there was common themes around what's needed for successful primary care. So greater efforts to coordinate the care for the high-risk patients. So again, I think this is what we're starting to see. This is what's happening now. We have health links. We have the connecting care to home. We have the C3 project. This is trying to identify some of those high-risk patients that we can do better for. They wanted to see improved direct telephone access and information exchange through shared electronic medical records. You know, and then clearly defined accountability There was a lot of discrepancy for pending discharge investigations. So something's been ordered, the result's not back, or an investigation is ordered. A lot of debate about who's responsible for that. The hospitalist group said, well, they're not in hospital anymore. It should be the primary care providers. The primary care providers in the study said, well, we didn't order it. It should be the hospital physicians. There were some interesting quotes that that resonated with me a little bit that they pulled out of this study. So this was a rural primary care physician or provider. I guess the magnitude of needing it, a discharge from it, doesn't necessarily always strike people who aren't trying to pick up the pieces in the back end. You know, and I felt this. I've experienced this. You know, sometimes there's a delay. Maybe the person on the other end doesn't think, oh, it's not that important to get this discharge summary out. But if you're trying to pick up the pieces on the other end, it is. You know, conversely, you know, the hospitalists, you know, talk about, so this is the hospitalist system, so they cover doctors. There's one primary care doctor we cover. He complains all the time that he never gets his history and physical, so his dictations. But he turns his fax off at 5 o'clock when he leaves. He doesn't leave it on over the weekend, and he has access to the EMR, but he doesn't go there. So I'm like, come on. Right? So, I mean, some of this is on us that, you know, there are things there that we can go and we can access to get some of that information. And this I think, kind of, to me, applies to both sides. There's one office in town that has incredible fortress that keeps you from speaking to the actual docs. So, you know, I can imagine this. This is what I call the emergency room sometimes. You know, sometimes you get right to a doc. Other times you get bumped around and nobody wants to talk to you and they tell you they're too busy. And I mean, I can only imagine from the other side, if someone's trying to get a hold of me, actually, I don't know what my staff does. They probably actually make it really hard for someone to get in touch with me. So again, there's lots that we can all be doing. This was just another study where they looked at something to reduce communication of medication discrepancies. So it was very simple. Basically, what they did is they had primary care providers communicate with the patient and the hospitalist who looked after their patient within 24 hours of discharge just to review the meds list. That was it. Review the meds list. They developed a system. It was really quick. They found half the patients out of the 240, I think it was, consecutive discharges had medication errors. And on average, they had more than two each discrepancies between the list. So again, just making people talk in a structured way, you know, improve patient safety. You may or may not have seen Health Quality Ontario put a report out last year right around this exact topic, experiencing integrated care, and comparing us to Ontario to other provinces, as well as Ontario and Canada to the other Commonwealth nations, from data from 2014. It's informational health policy survey is of older adults, they called it. Now, they did qualify that as 55 and older, so I apologize if that offends anyone, but older adults, 55 and older. Just a few select results from there. So you see, so Ontario will always be kind of the red bar. I know that it's a little bit hard to see the text, but so this question was, in the past 2 years when receiving care for a medical problem, was there a time when a test or medical records were not available at the time you scheduled your medical appointment? So for Ontario, it's about 15%. So coming up to one in five patients, when they came for their appointment, you didn't have the results ready for you. And you can see that's far down. Only Newfoundland and Labrador was a little bit worse. And when you look at on the right-hand side, so that's actually countries. So it's provinces on the left, countries on the right. Canada is in the red. Ontario is in the red slash marks, and that's Canada in the purple slash marks. You see, Ontario actually ranks really poorly in us having the results we need when the patient wants to have them. This question was around, in the past 2 years, was there a time when the specialist did not have basic information or test results from your regular doctor or place of care about the reason for your visit? So this one's on us. This is us not getting the information to the specialist that they need, or the specialist not being able to access it. And again, Ontario, I don't know why Quebec is a real big outlier there, but Ontario, you know, again, we're not performing very well. About 10% of the time, you know, we're not, it may be that we're not actually communicating with the specialist with the information they need. In the past 2 years, after you saw your specialist, was there a time that your regular doctor did not seem informed or up to date about the care you got from the specialist. And again, this is it was 18% for Ontario. So again, one in five times, patients are reporting, you know, my doctor didn't actually know what the specialist did. And this is creating quality of care issues. After you left the hospital, did doctors or staff at the place where you usually get medical care seem informed and up to date about the care you received while you were in the hospital? So on this one, it's kind of the opposite. The farther left on the slide, that's worse. So it was, again, about, so 77% of people said, yeah, they seemed like they knew about me being in hospital and what happened in hospital. So again, one in five patients are saying, you know, they actually didn't have that information. And when you look at us compared to other provinces, other countries, you know, we're not performing well. So where are we now? Well, we're trying really hard to communicate better. If only to let you know, I faxed you to say I've sent you an email asking you to call me. So it is a bit of a soup right now, where there's all kinds of different things happening. You know, some people know a little bit about a lot of these initiatives. Some people know lots about one. Lots of us don't know anything about any of them. So yesterday I was typing up, kind of trying to think of all the words that came to mind thinking about this topic. So it's very complicated. There's many different facets to this, many different initiatives that are actually happening. But there's good things. There's good things that happen. So this is another patient. This is a patient of mine from the office. Came to my office, saw a resident. Was concerned about having a couple episodes of chest pain in the last 24 hours. Wasn't having chest pain in the office. Had a shortness of breath and fever for the first few days. Has a vascular history, hypertension, lots of risk factors, congenital mitral valve defect. You know, the resident was quite concerned. The patient didn't look too well. You know, that this patient needs to go to the emerge. Because, you know, they could be an acute coronary syndrome. It might just be pneumonia. Wondered about endocarditis because there wasn't a real focal source for the fever. So I think, you know, quite appropriately, tried to contact the emergency room. I think ended up getting into a triage nurse that was sending this patient in and said, yeah, whatever. Did up a nice consult note, the history, our concerns, what we were looking for. About 4 hours later, we got a call to say, thank you so much for sending in, you know, your notes and your background on this patient. We've done some tests, we've done a chest x-ray, we've done troponins. This was really a reasonable person to send in. We're glad you did. They have pneumonia. We've put them on some antibiotics. We've asked them to follow up with you in 2 days to make sure that they're feeling better. Thank you very much. Have a good day. You should have seen the look on my nurse's face when she got this call. Never guess what just happened. The doctor called to tell us what happened with our patient. So this is what we're striving for. This is what we want. You know, we want to be able to communicate with each other, so we know how we're taking care of each other's patients. Just a little commentary in terms of my take on where we're at and why we're here a little bit more. I mean, so this is a really critical time for our healthcare system. No doubt there's a lot of changes. We're in a funding crunch. There's big changes likely coming to primary care in terms of the way we do our work and the way we're going to have to work with hospitals. In the last several years, you know, particularly in bigger centers like London, you know, family medicine has been seeing a widening gap from hospital. We're not working in hospitals as much. And as that gap widens, you know, we lose some of that personal interaction with our hospital colleagues. This is a critical time to try to improve the system. You know what, I think our patients really expect more. It's amazing when I talk to patients, they assume that we always get every test result and everything that the emergency room does and all the reports from the hospital. They just assume that it comes. And sometimes when you say, we don't have the report or we don't usually get that sent to us, they're floored that, you know, something as basic as transmitting information about them, you know, doesn't happen. No, and I think, you know, hospital-based physicians, hospitals, and primary care providers, you know, we need each other. to provide the optimal patient care. There's not really another option than to work better together. This is why I think it's so important that we've come together today. I think we need to own some of the problem as family doctors. From our offices, I think often we may be, complain about, our patients' experiences coming in at a hospital, the information that we don't have. I think we are a bit to blame for this at times too. We need to actually step up and do a better job to communicate with the hospital docs, on a consistent basis. To, have better ways that, if they want to get in touch with us, they can. We have to own that this isn't just a hospital problem, it's not a system problem. Some of it is our own behavior. My take two. I think we need some standardization and some clarity. Some of the studies have looked at, implementing really kind of simple standardized things. Even just with how to access, an eMERGE doc to run a case file, to send somebody into the eMERGE. When I talk to different docs in the community, different docs think there's different processes. Oh yeah, no, we just send them to the consult. No, we don't. We're not supposed to call them. Oh yeah, we always call them and there's a doctor's line and we can always talk to the doctor. Oh, I always just call and talk to the triage nurse. So there's lots of different things that I think, if we have some standardization and clarity, what's the best? Then we can start to do that consistently, and that's going to help. I think we need more or enhanced e-health solutions. There's lots of really great things right now. Clinical Connect, Hospital Report Manager, e-consult. There's lots of things out there that we're sort of dabbling in. There's little bits of using it. So I really think we need to look at how we can leverage some of these things, to narrow the gap. So I did the Ideas course. Brent and I did the Ideas QI Advanced Learning course at the University of Toronto. So I'm a big fan, a big proponent of, the quality improvement framework. Just kind of jumping in, doing small tests of change, learning something, and redoing it. So I think a lot of the things that we need to work on, we need to maybe take that quality improvement approach. Not study it too much, not think about it too much. Take an idea, get the stakeholders around, and just try it out. See how it works on a couple of patients. If it doesn't work, try something else. If it does work, try to expand it and spread it a little bit. Because we can really get sort of paralysis by analysis sometime, trying to really overthink things. One of the last points is if we don't come up with solutions, I think the government of the Lynn is going to do it for us. Things are changing, and if we don't get involved with participating in some of those changes, we're just going to get told, well, this is the new system, and it may or may not work for us. One last dimension of a study. So this was an e-health solution. There was a problem with that. We talked about it earlier. So pending investigations at discharge, who's responsible for them? How does the family physician know? So they looked at a bunch of patients. They created an EMR tool that basically all they did was generate a list of anything that was pending at discharge. It was very simple. It got sent out separate from the discharge summary. They compared the list. So they found over 260 patients, 70% of the patients had pending investigations when they were discharged, but only about 18% of them were reported in the dictations. By using this EMR tool and sending the information sort of separately, they had almost a 50% increase in primary care providers knowing about the pending investigations. So again, it's probably a pretty simple thing, that we can implement in an e-health solution, to try to tie up some of these loose ends. So hopefully I've given you a purpose of why we're here. I just did want to do a little public service announcement. So for the panel discussion, Adam's laughing. I told him I'd do this. Today to be about constructive things. We all have stories about how our internal medicine patient was discharged with a disaster, how those jerks in the eMERGE did something with our patients. That's not what today's about. Today's about dialogue. This is the first opportunity that we can talk to each other and actually, to be able to flesh out, hear from both sides, what the experience is. So today's about dialogue, it's about information sharing. You know, what's happening in internal medicine, in the eMERGE, in health records, in IT. You know, things that are happening that we can leverage to do a better job. It's about new ideas. So in the roving storm session, you know, we really want you to be solution focused. Talk about what's working well or how things could work better or ideas you have. Because we want to be able to take those ideas away from today and actually move forward with them as a department. Try to make some links with you know, some of the people here with the hospital to improve the care that we're doing. So it's about solutions, not about problems. We're going to be about solutions today. It's not a BMW session. If you know what that is. Somebody told me it means bread, meat, water. You can always know when you're at a fancy dinner, the order of where things are. So that leads us to the panel discussion. At this point, I'm going to bring up Dr. Sharon Koivu, who's the site chief for family medicine at University Hospital. She's a full-time palliative care physician there. I'm sure many of you or all of you likely know her, and she's going to introduce the panelists and get us rolling.
Thank you. I'm very excited to be here because this is something that has really affected me. So this is something I'm really looking forward to. I've been in family medicine for 30 years now. I started when I was 10, just like Jane. The first 17 years of my practice was in a family practice in St. Thomas. And we had a we took care of all of our in-hospital patients. We took care of the emergency department and did all our own OB. Following that, I spent the last 13 years in hospital. My first was at Parkwood, then I was back in St. Thomas, and now I'm working at London Health Sciences Center with a focused practice in palliative care and a hobby in addiction. I've been on every receiving end. I've been the family doc with a patient in front of me who'd been spending months at LRCP, and I had not one information about that patient. I've been the community physician that received a patient transferred from LRCP that was not as advertised. I'll just put it that way. They hadn't even spoken to the actual power of attorney to get any direction on this unconscious patient that never woke up but was sent for rehab. I've also been the person at the hospital trying to reach the family physician. And after 10 minutes of redial, I do delegate it to the resident. So usually it's not the office staff that I find challenging to get through. It's the office staff to get to. I don't know how many people know how long it actually takes the average patient or physician to get a human. And that to me has been my biggest struggle. Back in the olden days, we all had backdoor numbers that were available at the hospital. I don't know anybody's backdoor number anymore and can't tell you how long a time I've spent trying to do the right thing. So there's lots of things we can learn from each other. And this is a day about learning from each other and building bridges to be working together. So what we're going to do now is have the panelists probably come up essentially one at a time and then have all the panelists here to answer questions at the end. We decided to have it, all the questions at the end, because I've been the last panelist. When the questions went so long, there wasn't time for the panelists. So we want to make sure everybody has the opportunity today. So I also have had, it's been very exciting for me because I've been able to learn a lot about the people that are presenting today. So our first presenter is Dr. Adam Ducalo.
I
I learned a lot about Adam Duclos from getting his bio. I learned not only do we share the same beach, although I haven't run into him on it, he has a very, very outstanding biography. So he graduated from medical school at Western and then was trained as an emergency doc in Toronto. He also has been very involved in health administration with a certificate of health administration from the Canadian College of Health Service Executives. He's been working as an emergency department physician at London Health Sciences Center and an associate professor at Western. And he's now chief of the Citywide Department of Emergency Medicine and chair of the Division of Emergency Medicine for Schulich. I think what I've been most knowing Adam for is certainly the work he's been doing in the last 2 years to transform the emergency department. So this has been a major undertaking involving a lot of frontline people, a lot of other physicians, a team of 50, to really try to create an environment in which there are no wait times and that there's a complete new model of care, eliminating triage and having an improvement in how patients are seen and how fast things are done to improve quality of care and the patient experience. So that's been an exciting initiative that Adam's been involved in. So Adam, thanks for being here. So each speaker has 10 to 15 minutes, and then I pull the floor open.
Okay, so first and foremost, thank you everyone for attending, and thank you to the organizers for having me here to present today. I really have two goals in my presentation, having first talked to Scott about it a couple months ago. One is to describe what you may have heard about, you may not have, some of the transformational changes we're making in the process within the emergency department. The second is to sort of unveil the black hole, or whatever you want to call it, the black box of our emergency department. Give you some updates on how I think and others think we can better collaborate between the primary care community. This is in keeping with a lot of the work we've been doing with people like Alan to better collaborate between the eMERGE and where 15% of our patients go, the inpatient ward. So I'll start with my disclosures. I have none. If anyone knows a pharma company that wants to give me a ton of money, even though I only prescribe 5 days of pills at a time, please let me know. This presentation could last 2 hours. I'm trying to ram it into 10 minutes, and I'm happy to take questions at the end of it. But it's really the transformation piece is a story. And you may or may not be aware, depending how much you read of Jonathan Shear's work in the London Free Press, how bad of a state our emergency departments were in about a year ago or 2 years ago. We were the crowned, jeweled, worst performing emergency departments in the province. There are four metrics that our emergency departments are One is the time it takes to get in front of a doc from when you walk in the door. The other three are related to length of stay. So there's length of stay to get admitted to the hospital from when you walk in, length of stay for a high acuity patient that gets discharged to be discharged, and length of stay for a low acuity patient to be discharged. These graphs have become very familiar to my colleagues in emergency medicine. Red thing's not working very well, but if you look from left to right, we're looking at fiscal years. So on the far left, up top to bottom is December 2012, in the middle is December 2013, and on the right is December 2014. The green line is the average 90th percentile for this metric for all emergency departments in Ontario, 90th percentile. The rest of the bars, the gray ones, are and the blue and orange, academic tertiary care centers in Ontario, so being compared to our 12 or 13 peers. If you look across, you'll see the provincial average has barely changed over those 3 years. Orange is Vic and blue is UH. The only reason Vic was performing better than UH was because the pediatric eMERGE is included with the adult eMERGE, so the numbers are dismal for both, essentially. And this is the time it takes for someone to walk in the door to get admitted to the inpatient ward, so to leave the department. And the 90th percentile here is we're looking at sort of 35 hours for UH, so basically 2 days in the emergency department. I could break it down to different populations, but it's not really worth it. You can see nothing was really changing. This is the time it took to get in front of a doc, 90th percentile. So 90% of patients would get in front of the doc, in front of a doc, within about 4 hours. But again, near or at the worst in the province for PIA or physician initial assessment time, and staying that way. So when I presented this to other groups, they talk about, you know, why should we care? We all sort of care when we work in the PIT or in the emergency department because people are miserable when you see them. We know their health outcomes are probably worse. But more recently, it's been published that essentially when people wait longer, there's at least a correlation with increased mortality and morbidity. So having the long wait times potentially relates to increased morbidity and mortality. We should also care because we're all, most of us are all citizens within the community of London and Middlesex. And when patients are waiting longer to be seen by a doc, we create offload delays. So we have had some of the worst offload delays in the province as well, in keeping with the time it takes to see a doc. What does this do to a group of providers? I really don't know what came first. Was it boarded patients or us changing how we work by layering on so many extra pieces in the process to delay care in the emergency department? And I think it was probably a bit of both. If you asked me 2 years ago, what the problem in eMERGE was, why were our times so bad, I would have said it's 90% boarding, 10% eMERGE process. Now I think it's 50-50, having gone through the transformation that we've gone through. What I mean by boarding is a patient that's admitted, has admission orders, but is sitting in the department waiting to go to the ward. If you ask my colleagues at that time, and some of them still now, they would say it's 98% boarding and 2% what we do in the eMERGE and how we process patients. And that is defended. It's a defendable position. ASEP, the American College of Emergency Physicians, Canadian Association of Emergency Physicians, every body that writes about eMERGE flow will cite that at least 80% of the problem is related to boarding of inpatients. It makes logical sense. If you're a surgeon and you have 10 ORs that you're expected to ramp up at 8 in the morning and 9 of them are closed for some reason or another, you cannot run 10 ORs in one. We come into work as recently as yesterday, 31-bed eMERGE at UH, 28 beds are full of inpatients. VIC, 42 beds, 39 beds full of inpatients. So it's not necessarily a 50-50 problem, and it's not one or the other. What we came to is that we need to work on both. So we can compartmentalize the problem, and I'll speak to the input phase, which is kind of what Scott was getting to, about how do you get someone into the eMERGE appropriately, a little bit later in the presentation after I talk about the transformation itself. Throughput is really where the eMERGE Department System Transformation Project is focused on. That's within our control. So regardless of the constraint of boarding, regardless of the constraint of increased volumes or change in acuity, what can we control within the 4 walls, 10 walls of the emergency department? And then output, this is really where we talk about boarding. The only reason, well, it's 2 reasons I took on this challenge a few years ago, was because I believed it was solvable. And I believed it was important challenge to take on. I believe that not only could we solve the throughput piece if we improved our processes, but I also looked long and hard at the data that when we had boarding, we had no boarding, we still had poor metrics in eMERGE. I also looked at our length of stay for our patients that were admitted, and our average length of stay still to this day is longer than our peers. So Scott mentioned, or one of the first presenters mentioned, that people are getting discharged sooner. They may be, but we're still worse in terms of length of stay for patients in London on average than our colleagues at other tertiary care centers. We also admit more people. So you may think it's impossible to get somebody in the hospital. We admit about 2 to 3% more people than our peers in the province. So I didn't believe that it was a 100% resource problem, that maybe we do need more beds. But I feel that we need to fix our own ship first, shorten our length of stay, and decrease our admission rates. But how do you take a group of docs and nurses that have been working in an environment where they really have felt no control for years? At times, 90% of their department is boarded patients, it's overrun, the wait times are 12, 14 hours, 100 people in the emergency department, in the department at 4 in the morning, when I walked into work a year ago. You know, 60 people waiting to be seen, some of them 14 hours. By myself, 4 in the morning, expected to get through that list. So we focus on what we control and break constraints where possible. We control the throughput. In my view, the input and output are constraints. constraints require you to work with people outside of your influence or outside of your control to break them, whereas within the walls of our department, we control how things work. We gathered what I call a coalition of the willing, 50 different providers, as Sharon mentioned. There's about 15 or 16 docs, 30 nurses, orderlies, floor, everybody got on this team. We came up with some goals, easier, faster, better. And we went through a process. We used the Toyota production systems under the influence of one of my colleagues, Muhammad Shanti. But really, at the end of the day, what we've come to is that if you Google process improvement, it's all some facsimile of the same thing. You observe a process, you map it out, you think of something by removing the waste, and then you try it. And you don't wait for perfection. As healthcare providers, at least my colleagues, wanted to see perfection before they even tried something. We've unfrozen that now. We're trialing things that never would have been imaginable a year ago by just giving it a try. Everything from emotional intelligence training for emergency physicians to a new process at triage. So this is was our process circa 2015, so not too long ago. If you walked into UH the pointer's not working, essentially walked through a rotating door. If you were slow, it hit you in the butt. You went up, you asked, what do I do? And number two, and number three, you sat in a chair, you waited for someone to register you at number four, then you got put back in a chair until you saw a triage nurse at six. If you need an ECG, you went to seven, you got your ECG, got put back in the waiting room at number eight. Number nine, you came back and got reassessed by another reassessment nurse, and then you went to number 10 and waited again, and then eventually you got into one of these stretchers in a poor area where a third nurse saw you, then a medical student, then a doc, and then you got some tests or some value-added steps. We've essentially eliminated steps 1 through 10, non-value-add steps to a patient. When a patient comes to the emergency department, they want to see someone that can make decisions about what investigations, treatment, and disposition that they need. Triage is a disaster tool that was meant to be used in wartime or disaster situations when your resources are outstripped by your demand. It started out with very good intentions in the emergency departments in the early 80s and was adopted at UH just in 1996. As a way to manage weights and manage resources. But I don't believe our resources should be overwhelmed every day. This is our new system. You may have heard of the bubbles. Basically, you come in the front door, first in, first out, no triage. A nurse looks at you and divides you up between one of three care teams based on the perceived workload. So immediately you get in to see a doc, two nurses, an orderly, and a comm clerk that are working as a team doing their assessments at the same time and making decisions. Everyone comes into that front bubble, save the resuscitative patients, which is less than 1% of the people that we see. We discharge about 30% of those people within an hour right from the front bubble. Another 55 to 60% go to the middle bubble. We think they need about 3 hours of care. That's where they would get a CT for diverticulitis to make sure they don't have an abscess that makes them need to come out of the hospital. Those types of things, your asthma, get them turned around, some treatments. And then about 15% of people go right to the back bubble and get admitted, hopefully within an hour or two, to one of our inpatient services. They obviously need to be admitted to hospital. We call the internists as early on, because we're no longer adding value to the care as possible. We know they need to be admitted. We know probably what the problem is and get them admitted. This focus is very much on continuing people moving and stopping my involvement when I don't add value to their care anymore so I can continue to see people up front. We had to do some renovations. This is UH. Basically, you'll see there's you can see two of the three production teams. Each production team has three stretchers and six chairs, so everyone gets processed through there. 200 patients a day at UH and 150 so patients a day at, or 200 patients a day at Vic, 150 or so at UH. What are the results of this? So with sporadic implementation of the new system, renovating both emergency departments, and really probably operating under the new process of care maximum 10% of the time last year, which is by unfreezing culture and changing how people work, we saved 1,000 hours of offload 2015, 20% drop. And most of those hours were saved between October and December. You'll see these are our metrics for the past 4 years. You'll note that they're essentially exactly the same until the November, December 2015. It's more striking at UH. We finally dropped below that provincial average, and there's obviously seeing some improvements in our metrics. That same graph I showed you for admitted length of stay, this is December 2015. See provincial average? Orange on the far right, UH is almost the best in the province. This is a lot due to work by people like Alan Gobb and Faisal Rahman and UH Internal Medicine to get people moving onto the ward quicker. I can tell you these numbers, this is our PIA, are the best they've been since they started recording these metrics in 2008. Their PI had never been under 3 hours, 2.4, 2.5 hours at UH. So why a smiley and a sad face? Unfortunately, despite the system working, the past 2 to 3 weeks, we've seen increased boarding, like I mentioned earlier on, in the department. So you could get rid of boarding tomorrow. If we kept our old system, our metrics wouldn't improve. But if you don't get rid of boarding, no matter what system we put in place, people are still going to wait. So very quickly, this is the collaboration piece. I think in general, most of our family docs or other providers in the city do a very good job of doing these types of things that help prevent or divert emergency department admissions. I can tell you one of the pet peeves of emerge docs is when I call to speak to a family doctor and the first thing I hear is, if I'm not available, please don't go to a walk-in clinic, go to emerge or the urgent care center. You know, walk-in clinics, I think, have a place. If you're not available and someone has a very minor problem, they shouldn't go wait 4 hours in the emergency department. And I know there's different reasons for doing that, but it has a place. How do you get somebody in the best way possible? The communication piece is key. It's not one doc. I mean, even 10 years ago when I started training, or 15 years ago, there was one doc at Vic most of the time. When you call in and talk to me at 4 in the afternoon, there's three other docs working at Vic, and chances are I'm not going to see that patient. So it's a little less important for that verbal conversation, but the written note or fax or whatever, if the patient brings it with them, is very helpful because we have that information no matter who ends up seeing the patient. In terms of output, I really think, this is one of the things Scott and I've talked about in the past, we can improve how ED physicians communicate. We discharge 85% of people that come to the emergency department. Only 15% or so, or 17 at UH, get into an inpatient bed. I've drafted this form. It's an LHC official form that I just need to roll out, that I'm hoping that any patient that we feel actually needs to follow up with the family doctor, because frankly, half of them, it's an individual visit, we can just send. We can send them home with this form. So, sorry for the very quick presentation. Thank you very much for your time, and I'm happy to take questions after the when it's appropriate to do so.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Our next speaker is another doctor. Dr. Alan Gobb. He has been an assistant professor, Department of Medicine, Division of Hematology, since 2013. He has his master's of science in quality improvement and patient safety at the University of Toronto. And his academic interests include application of quality improvement principles to his clinical environment, inpatient and outpatient consultation of hematology, and inpatient general internal medicine. He's been very involved in initiatives about how to improve discharge planning, and communication around discharge.
Can everyone hear me? Okay. Thank you for asking me to be part of your retreat. I feel a really good constructive energy from you guys, from my primary care colleagues and from Adam. And I think it's really great to have something like this where we can all get together. I kind of was just reflecting when Adam was talking. It's great because we've got the front end process with merge, back end with primary care, and then us kind of squarely in the middle as internal medicine. And what a process it is, actually. I'm just going to get this all up there. Before I start talking about what exactly this is, because it looks a little bit busy and complicated, I'm going to say I'm a relative newbie when it comes to public speaking and speaking in forums. So I actually forgot to add my disclosure slide. So I have nothing to disclose. I'm a frontline grunt just with my pants and shirt. I have absolutely nothing that people want to pay me for. So what this is our conceptual model of what it means to get someone through the internal medicine process safely and efficiently. And so this was the result mainly from the IHI's white paper on safe discharge, with a couple of tweaks that are specific to internal medicine at LHSC. And what I'd like to do here for you today is just kind of talk to you about some of the things that we as a department, an organization really, are doing to try and address, you know, how can we get patients through safely, i.e. prevent readmissions, and efficiently, i.e. reduce the length of stay. And this has really come down from the organization's goal to get occupancy under 95%, which is a very, very ambitious goal, but it's also a very, very good opportunity to fix something that, in my opinion, has been broken for a while. I'm sure that a lot of you have probably come through the CTUs at University Hospital and Victoria Hospital and probably reflected to yourself, you know, a lot of this stuff could be done better, more efficiently, and with more consistency. And I would totally agree with that. So I'm not going to get into the entire detail of the model here. What I hope to do is just kind of give you an overview, talk to you about maybe a couple of the projects that I think probably apply most directly to you, one in particular that I've been involved in personally, and then hopefully use that as a jumping point for the discussion that's going to happen subsequently. So these are like the five pillars of safe discharge in mine, and I guess in the IHI's opinion. So what do you want to do in order to get someone through safely? You want to make sure that you're anticipating their needs by assessing them as an inpatient early for their potential post-discharge needs. You want to be teaching your patients all the way through. You want to make sure that upon discharge, stuff doesn't fall through the cracks. So high fidelity, very accurate and timely handoffs, speaking to Scott's project. And once they do leave, you want to make sure that they are assessed early so that you can course correct as necessary, as early as possible. And onto that, so those are the four IHI pillars. We added a fifth pillar, which is the timeliness and the coordination, because you can't really create a safe and efficient discharge if every member of the healthcare team is pulling in a different direction. And lastly, over top of that, is you need both the time as well as the skills in order to carry out those five things. Because often we're assigning our discharge summaries and our discharge processes to the most junior person on the team, the med students or the junior resident, and they just haven't done enough of these in order to be truly proficient at them. So the couple of the pillars that I wanted to go into just a little bit of detail about. So the transition, the handoff, the little kind of automatic sign that's there to represent Scott's project of the auto authentication for the discharge summaries, which has been really, really successful at making sure that at least the core pieces of the discharge summary gets to primary care in a timely manner. The other one, the little man that's talking on the phone there, I'm going to talk to you about in detail. That's a pilot project that I was involved in, which involves direct doctor-to-doctor handover at the time of discharge. The last piece that I'll just talk to you about briefly is in the efficiency and coordination piece. We're actually working right now on a project to have pharmacists involved more fully at the time of discharge to make sure that the medications that the patient goes home on are accurate. And so this is a pervasive problem throughout the hospital stay that actually begins on admission, because we don't have an accurate medication list when the patient walks through the door. that error propagates throughout the patient's entire hospital stay. And by the time they leave, and by the time that discharge summary, which has been dictated by a third-year med student a lot of times, with not a lot of experience doing a medication reconciliation, by the time that hits you, it's kind of a dog's breakfast, and you have no idea what exactly happened in the hospital stay. So these are just a few of the projects that are part of this giant overarching umbrella that our organization has taken on to really, really kind of destroy and rewrite the admission to discharge process in internal medicine from scratch. So I'm just going to share with you a small piece, which I was involved with as a pilot back in the fall when I was on as the CTU2 attending. And so this was a pilot looking to see if we could get the CTU teams and the primary care physicians actually talking on the phone at the time of discharge. Because right now, what happens is we tell the patients, okay, for these things, follow up with your family doctor. We hope it happens. Sometimes it happens. More often it does not. And so we wanted to ensure, we wanted to be proactive in making sure that A, patient actually had a family physician appointment within 7 days, ideally, and two, that family physician, when the patient showed up in the office, was aware of what he or she had to follow up on. And so that was through a phone call. And so this is a little workflow sheet, which you're not intended to read, but I'll walk through it. So at the time, when the patient is T-minus 72 hours to discharge, or yellow, according to our predictive discharge model, at that point, they would hand the sheet to the unit clerk. And so the first step is the unit clerk would try and call the family physician's office and make an appointment within 7 days. If they couldn't do that, they stopped, if for whatever reason they couldn't reach. If they were able to reach the family physician's office, the next step was to ask the admin assistant whether or not the family physician would want to get telephone handover. And if the answer was yes, then the unit clerk would ask, okay, what is the best way to reach the family physician and what time is convenient for them? And so that information would be relayed to the team member, and then that conversation would, in theory, happen. So that's how we imagined this process to occur. And just the pilot's complete, so I can share with you some of the results and the learnings, and we'll use that as a jumping point. So in 2 weeks, there were 47 people discharged from my service. Of those 47 people, 34 had that flow sheet from the last slide given to the unit clerk. So of those 34, about two-thirds of those phone calls resulted in successful communication with someone from the front office staff. Of those 24, about 9 said yes, we think that a telephone handover team to primary care would be useful. And of those 9, only about half actually were documented to occur. So out of 47, when you drill it all down, we had just like a slightly above 10% success rate in terms of making those two things actually happen. And the learnings from this pilot, which mainly came from feedback, qualitative feedback from the people involved, the junior trainees, the unit clerks, they found that it was actually quite difficult for the unit clerks to reach a human, as Dr. Koivu mentioned, so that was corroborated. I think that one of the other pieces of feedback was that wasn't as much the case when the trainee themselves tried to contact the family physician. Because for a few of these patients, there were really mission-critical things that had to get followed up on that I kind of just insisted that they try directly to reach. And just qualitatively and anecdotally, the trainees, when they called themselves, were much So I think what overall this little pilot project told me, the learning points, is that the system as it's set up currently really creates a lot of barriers for that very important conversation to happen. And a lot of this is still driven by individual practitioners' desire to make that happen. The success is really not built into the system per se. So I think that going forward, we really need to take much more of a systems approach and make sure that if something is important like that, that it gets actually baked into the way we do things and is part of our standard work and our expectation of our practitioners. So that's just my small slice of what we're doing as internal medicine at LHSC. And hopefully that's a good jumping point for the discussion that's to follow.
Is Dr. Tom Jensen, who has another very interesting portfolio. I think that he would be could be described as an original geek, but I don't think the word is twisted yet. He managed the second microcomputer store in Canada when he was only 17. So that's probably before I even knew how to turn on computer. Partly because I was very late doing that. Just hang on. I was a computer illiterate person. Was that not right? I was computer illiterate until I was much older. Not that long ago.
And now I'm a born again computer geek. So he graduated from the University of Western Ontario in 1987 and has been very active in the College of Family Physicians. He spent 15 years in family practice with a special interest in mental health, and now he has a primary care focused practice in mental health at Parkwood. He's developed numerous grassroots programs for managing mental health in a primary care setting with specific interests in depression and anxiety disorder, bipolar disorder, adult ADHD, and early presentations of psychotic illness in the primary setting. He's had a huge speaking portfolio, being an international speaker and having been the keynote presenter 2,000 times. I can't even imagine that. I thought I did a lot of talking. Just speaking of talking, unlike Scott, I'm having difficulty talking today, not because I was yelling at a hockey game, but because I actually have been sick. I had the worst laryngitis last week and couldn't say anything. So I'm glad I can talk now, because those who know me know I love to talk. So sorry for my voice. And then just back to Dr. Jensen. He's the chief medical officer for the London Health Sciences Center in St. Joe's since 2003. So I'd like to welcome him.
So thank you very much. I'm a little upset after watching the last presentation. I mean, it certainly speaks volumes of the opportunity that is available to us to improve on processes. One of the things that really struck me when I first started working in the hospital setting, and I'm the guy that didn't want to move to hospitals to avoid the politics, but one of the things that really struck me was this lack of communication between specialty care and primary care. And I can remember, it still has an impact on me, sitting there and watching two of my psychiatry colleagues sitting at the workstation around where the nurses were, and a phone call coming in from a family doc wanting to speak to somebody about their patient. And the psychiatrist, both were sitting there going, no, you take it to the nurse. And I thought, you're sitting there, I don't know what you're doing, but pick up the phone and speak to the family doc. So this culture or this divide that we're talking about today has been longstanding. And so I think your experience in trying to get through is part of the fact that this has not been the culture that we've had. So we can blame one side, we can blame the other side, but it's both sides that have to say, We're talking about patients here. We're talking about what's best for our patients. And I mean, it almost takes away from any impact of what I'm about to say using technology, because in many ways, forget the technology. What we're talking about is people talking to people. Physicians having mutual respect for one another's busy schedules and saying, we're all busy. Every one of us is busy. You know, to sit here and say the doctor's busy is absolutely absurd when we're talking about a patient and we're talking about the care that we provide. So, I mean, really for me, I want to focus on what you talked about and saying 47 patients and we only had 5 physician-to-physician contacts. That number should be 47. No questions asked. If somebody is prepared on the specialty side to pick up the phone and speak to the primary care provider, providing there is a primary care provider, that should happen 100% of the time. And to me, it's absolutely horrible to think that that can't happen in London, Ontario. So that would be my message. And what I'm about to say, while I get excited about technology, here's the real opportunity for me. Technology can help us. I have no specific disclosures around what's going on here today and what I'm going to present. I'm not getting paid anything to talk today that I know about, unless you've got something hidden away that at the end of the... Then I would have to disclose that after. Adam, you didn't... nothing so far. Okay, all right. So I want to talk a little bit about communications that should happen, and I actually believe I might have been responsible for some of the initiatives that happened back when I was in primary care. Because I can remember my patients going and showing up in Emerge and then me seeing them 2 or 3 days ago and saying, you know, I was in Emerge last week and I spent 24 hours in there. And I said, oh, and they thought, you should know about that. And they said, well, I have no idea. And how would I know? So that was back, way, way back in 1988. And I thought it was ridiculous that we weren't somehow notified that our patients had been seen in Emerge, much less when they were admitted to hospital. And so then look at the flow of information across these areas. But back then, what happened was the patient would be given, I don't know if this still happens, a little yellow, and I couldn't find a yellow picture, a piece of paper, a triplicate copy of whatever went on in ER. And to try and decipher what was written on that piece of paper was an exercise. But there was no actual automated notification system available until 2001 when this system came out. Remember this? Now, how many people subscribe to the, and how many people still rely on that today? Wow, interesting. Even with all the advances with Spire, how many Spire people are in the room? How many people get Spire? About half? Okay. So there's exciting opportunities, but this system, which is just an electronic notification system via email to say your patient had an encounter at one of our hospitals, doesn't give you any information per se, but at least you know the patient's name and that they had an encounter at one of our hospitals, and then we can do the digging from there. The Spire project is about 4 years old now, and for those that have it, it's been amazing, really, that the discharge summaries are now populating your electronic medical record. That's a big advance, and there's big advances that are happening beyond that now, and we want to talk a little bit about those. I was interested in the case that was presented. I think, Scott, you talked about a patient where the discharge summary was dictated, but it hadn't been authenticated, and for that reason, you didn't receive it. And I think we'll hear this from Brenda later, but the authentication process triggers the distribution of documents currently in our system. But let me let you in on a little surprise. Clinical Connect, I didn't know this until about 10 minutes ago because I logged into the system to look at some dictations that I did yesterday, and said, I wonder if they're available in Clinical Connect before I authenticate them. Guess what? They are. So I was able to see a note from a patient I saw, one of Sonny's patients yesterday in my outpatient clinic. I was able to see that note in Clinical Connect before I authenticated it. Now, the test is going to be whether you can see that note in Clinical Connect, but I think you will be able to, because I don't think it's specific to provider. So even before I authenticate or sign off that note, you should be able to see it in Clinical Connect. Sorry? You can in PowerChart, but then you have to actually know that the patient, or you have to have access. And I don't think all primary care providers currently have access unless they have a hospital privilege appointment. They're not going to have access, but Clinical Connect is going to be available to all providers across the board. And that's huge. And that's going to include a lot more than the information that you see here currently through Spire.
So we are in the process right now of a new project that is going to transition from Spire Hospital Report Manager, which was very localized to Arlen, and going to expand to what the province has adopted through Ontario MD called the HRM. Now, this was an initiative that happened up north of Toronto around Orillia Barrie area, and so it's going to be sort of Spire turbocharged a little bit. And the idea is that this will be a bi-directional sort of link where information that you have housed within your EMR will be pushed up for emergency room physicians to be able to see, and vice versa. That link is already there, that you're seeing the hospital information through the hospital report manager that's pushing those reports out to you. And we can talk a little bit about this. We don't have a lot of time to get into a lot of detail. Some of the advances that have made huge impact. OLIS, that's been talked about for, I don't know, 50 years, as long as I've been in practice, the Ontario Lab Information System, but finally it's here. It's in prime time. And to have the ability to not only see the lab results from patients who are treated in private clinics or private labs, but also now our hospital is contributing to the OLIS repository. So you get a cumulative look at all lab results, irrespective of where those tests were completed. So it's just recently, in the last couple of years, that we, London Health Sciences, St. Joseph's, our core lab is now contributing to the Ontario Lab Information System, so you can see lab data that was done in hospital. Prior to that, it was only the private lab data that was available. And we've also been able to deliver trending across labs. Different labs. So if somebody gets one test done at Gamma, another one done at Life Labs, another one done in the hospital, we've been able to actually, with the work we've done with eHealth, be able to show that trend across different labs with the norms actually documented, providing they're using the same sort of calibration. But you can see, I don't know if anyone's had the opportunity to look at that, but that's a powerful tool that's really really been big. And we have that through both the hospital system, through PowerChart, and also we do that through the OLIS viewer that we've delivered. And Clinical Connect, I'm happy to say that on Friday, we've been really working closely with the developers of Clinical Connect to duplicate that functionality in the Clinical Connect tool. But you'll see that trending across different labs, which is incredibly powerful when you're treating patients, particularly for chronic disease management. DPV, the drug profile viewer, I could spend an hour talking about that. Suffice to say, that was a huge win for the province, and it was physicians pushing the government to say, we need access to the information. You're paying for drugs in the province, but physicians have no access to that sort of database of which drugs are being paid for. What percentage of drugs that are dispensed in the province of Ontario are paid for by your tax dollars? Anyone want to guess? What do you think? Anybody? Someone said 80? Wow. We're not quite there, 70%. I'm shocked by that. I think 80%, my goodness. It's but 70% of the drugs dispensed in the province. Now, one would argue, and this is something that hopefully we come up with when we talk in our small groups, one would argue that if I only get 70% of the drugs that are dispensed in the province, I need 100% to really be the source of truth. There's a paper published by one of the pharmacists that works at UHN in Toronto through an initiative that Canada Health InfoWay had that said, is some information on some drugs on some patients better than no information on any drugs at any time? And the answer is an astounding yes, it's huge impact. In fact, the medication errors went from 30% down to 1% based on the availability of just the information within the current DPV viewer. That's shocking, and I think it really means that we need to leverage the information we have today and make it available to more clinicians. So I'm on a little bit of a rant about that. The other thing is the NMS, which is the narcotics monitoring system that came up a while ago, that says all control medications. These are all of your narcs, your psychostimulants, your benzodiazepines that are currently being marketed or being monitored. Do you know you have no access to that information at all? By law, even if the patient says, oh yeah, you go ahead and look at the NMS, the Narcotics Monitoring Service, I'll give you permission, where do I sign? You still can't get access to the information on the controlled substances that your patient's being given across problems. That's sad. So, last thing, the cumulative drug profile strategy. I've been able to work with other CMIOs, other people in my position across the province, and lobby the Ministry of Health, and lobby eHealth, and also working with Canada Health InfoWay around the cumulative drug profile strategy, which is a brand new project that's coming out. What you have today in lab information, every other province in the country has with respect to medication. And I would say the single point, the single biggest challenge, the challenges that you painted, are around medication management at the transitions of care. This is where errors are occurring all the time. It's horrible that we have to hire a pharmacist to take that on to make sure that what you intend the patient to be on when you discharge them from hospital is actually what they're going to take when they leave the hospital. We should have that information electronically, and we're pushing the government hard on this right now. They're hearing our voice, and I'm delighted to say that actually on March 10th, we've got the entire contingent from the Ministry of Health coming here to London to visit our site and work with us because we said we need clinical input in this. There's not been physicians engaged in some of these, what I would say are transformative technology initiatives that can change care. So physicians rarely get involved in stuff until it actually impacts them. Well, we need to be doing this proactively and pitching the government to say, we don't want to end up where I don't have access to the drug information you do. The government's got it. We as physicians, clinicians should have it, and our patients expect that we do. So I'm going to close on that note, and hopefully we get some good discussion here with the panel. Thank you.
Why you're so often a keynote speaker. Our last speaker on the panel, and that we'll have an opportunity to ask you questions to, is Brenda O'Reilly Grinnell. She has spent almost 30 years of experience in the healthcare sector. She is currently the Integrated Citywide Director of Health Information Management for London Health Sciences Center and St. Joe's Health Center, Healthcare Center. Brenda has also been an author or co-author for the first and second editions of the Health Information Management textbook, Fundamentals of Health Information Management. Brenda remains on the CHIM Board of Directors and has been a member of the Program Advisory Committee for the Center for Distance Education for Westerville College and has an educational consultant for the Canadian Healthcare Association for a number of years. So let's welcome her.
Okay, hello? Okay, I'm on. Okay, so thank you everyone for joining, for asking me to join with you this morning. And Here we go. So again, I don't have any relationships to declare here for today. So as Scott mentioned, I was on an ideas project with himself and Bob Durad from the Lynn, and its ideas is improving and driving excellence across sectors. And it was a project on discharge summaries, and it was a provincially applied learning strategy designed and delivered in Ontario for Ontario to support the healthcare system in achieving progress on Ontario system priorities. IDEAS is delivered through a collaborative partnership between Ontario's 7 Faculties of Medicine and Health Sciences, Health Quality Ontario, and the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences, and the Institute of Health Policy, Management, and Evaluation of the University of Toronto. So our aim statement and our goal was to increase the discharge summaries to primary care providers within 48 hours from the internal medicine group by 50%, so that would be increasing it from current 30% up to 45%. So there was an informal audit done by a couple of primary care providers, and as you can see, delayed transcription had zero impact. We've had excellent turnaround times. Delayed dictation was somewhat of a concern and had an impact on providing the information to the primary care providers, but the main reason for the delay in receiving the documents to the primary care providers was in the authentication. So because discharge summaries are not distributed to anyone CC'd, including primary care providers, until it has been electronically authenticated by the author or the attending physician. So auto-authentication would allow for documents to be immediately distributed to any CCs upon transcription, and the document would be labeled dictated but not read or reviewed. So what some of the barriers were encountered with this initiative was, within a teaching organization, a majority of the discharge summaries are dictated by a resident, and some physicians are reluctant to have those notes distributed prior to the review, despite having the statement dictated but not reviewed on the document. For the pilot, there was issues with management of the residents when they're transitioning from one attending who supported auto-authentication and one who does not. And not all physicians have provided us with fax numbers, so it's difficult to get the information to the primary care providers if we don't have a fax number for them. It's impossible to get a hard copy to them within 48 hours of discharge. With a hospital peer review that was conducted, approximately 60% of the hospitals we reviewed supported the auto-authentication. And effective April 1st, 2015, we did get approval for the new clinical documentation completion policy by MIC, and this policy included mandating that discharge summaries be completed electronically. So that means that they are either dictated or completed through advanced clinic notes or ACNs. So we did receive conditional support to expand the pilot within internal medicine from MAC. However, we were advised to get an opinion from the CMPA. So the opinion received was that they did support the idea of getting dictations released to physicians in a timely manner. They realized that releasing unauthenticated reports is more the norm than the exception. No matter when authentication, a dictation is distributed, the dictating physician is ultimately responsible for its content. They also indicated that there should be a clear disclaimer on the document and that providing physicians with guidance and guidelines about what to include in the dictations would be recommended to decrease the chance of dictation errors that was transcribed and then distributed. So we really need to have a clear process for physicians to send corrections back to health information management to have that document reposted and then redistributed. However, this could be significant resource intensive internally. Rolled out beyond just discharge summaries. So quality of dictation, a lot of work has been done on the actual content of the discharge summary, and we do have clinical documentation improvement as a core business now at London Health Sciences Center. Because we know documentation is extremely important, and if it isn't documented, it didn't happen. Have provided some education and support to the physicians on the important criteria to include within the discharge summary. Discharge summary criteria is important for not only the continuity of care, but also assists health information management in accurately reporting to the Ministry of Health. And this information is used by them to assess the complexity of care we are providing and allocate appropriate funding and derive performance metrics. So we did implement a new inpatient face sheet to be used as a guide for the discharge summary format. Our tip sheets and pocket cards that are also available for the
been utilizing the quality of documentation, the content of discharge summary model that the Ministry of Health has indicated, and that triggers to identify within the discharge summary admitting diagnosis, most responsible diagnosis, any procedures or interventions while in hospital, discharge dispositions. It's important for us to know whether the patient was actually discharged home or if they were discharged to a nursing home or community care. So this is the physician tips sheet, and the trigger for this was really the HSMR scoring. So it indicates a lot of the criteria required for palliative care to identify patients with palliative care with flagged interventions. But we also have the dictation guide, which indicates some clear criteria to indicate and provide additional information, not only for the primary care providers, but for health information management reporting as well. So our next steps. Effective March 1st, I'm happy to say that all family physicians will be automatically CC'd on all discharge summaries unless otherwise indicated by the dictator. So one of the risks associated with this is that the hospital doesn't do a really good job of identifying the accurate, correct family physician. So there's a risk of getting return mail from the incorrect family physicians identified, and that would only result in increased workload in-house as well. And we're also hoping to eliminate the mail out of hard copy mail with the implementation of Clinical Connect and with Hospital Report Manager coming on board and with the ability to fax. We're hoping that it wouldn't be necessary to still provide hard copy mail, snail mail to the family physicians as well.
Thank you very much for a very informative start to our day. What we'd like to do now is take 15 minutes to take questions from the audience and then have our break at that time. So anyone want to start with any questions?
And we want to record the questions, so I'll move around with the mic. Yes, Sylvia, you have a question?
Actually, I have a couple of comments.
Sure.
Which could be changed?
I'm a complete newbie when it comes to these. So I'm Sylvia Orsini, and I'm a family physician in the community. And there's a couple things that I was very interested to hear. Number one, Dr. Gobb, when you were looking at the discharge summary process and sort of identifying that often the most junior trainee is the one doing these dictations on fairly complex patients that are being discharged. And I absolutely think we should be re-looking at that. I don't know that a third-year medical student should be dictating, you know, the person on the internal medicine ward that has like six different diagnoses and numerous things that need to be followed up on. And so I actually think that's a great idea. I think, you know, if a person goes in for an operation and they had no problems and they go home, like that's an easy, quick dictation for a medical student. I'm not sure they should be doing these dictations. And I also think that it's important to be looking at the discharge summary itself. And so I actually welcomed your presentation because I think that sometimes the most important information in so that kind of thing, it does need to be, you know, either highlighted or brought to attention. So I think making sure that those things are highlighted rather than being buried, and having the person that's doing the dictation have some idea of what that information should be is really important.
Yeah, sure. I'd love to comment. Thanks very much for your comment, and I 100% agree. We've thought about, you know, some Band-Aid solutions, having someone more senior dictate or have some structured way. I think ultimately the holy grail of the discharge summary would be a running problem list throughout the patient's hospital stay that's electronic and that is cumulative, so that upon discharge, rather than trying to dig through like a chart this thick, you already have everything that's automatically spat out on the discharge summary in a nice user-friendly way. And you could even have like user being the end primary care physician and user being the patient in a patient-friendly manner. These are things that we're looking at as like, is this even possible? We've got some technologic hurdles to overcome with the implementation of Hugo. We're still working out kinks, but that's what I would see as the ultimate, you know, holy grail solution.
Yeah, I mean, I can comment on that as well, that certainly our next major project that we're going to be embarking on in the hospitals is clinical documentation, which will be structured documentation where they're required fields. And just to the point that's being made, the discharge summary will be a dynamic document that starts with the point of admission through, whether it's emergency department or a planned admission. The discharge summary will be generated and will be a live document that's viewable at any point during the care that's provided. And so it would be a seamless transition in an ideal world. I mean, but certainly clinical documentation and the synoptic capture of data, which means essentially that data fields are mineable, that we can start to look at some of the data that currently is being hand-picked through by the coders in Brenda's department to try and determine exactly what happened to that patient. These are not clinical people, but they're trying to capture that patient journey. And so I sat on the committee for this sort of optimizing clinical documentation project, and I learned a ton about how hospitals are funded based on the complexity of care. And, you know, some of the numbers that Adam said, you know, some of our hospitals are ranking lower than provincial average has nothing to do with the patients we're providing care to or the care we're providing for that matter, but it has everything to do with what's being documented and captured within that documentation. And I think physicians often don't recognize the importance of documenting everything that happens along that journey.
So I totally agree about the content in the discharge summary, because a four-page discharge summary isn't necessarily a good discharge summary. So we need to clearly identify what's important, especially when we're paying cost per minute for dictation. We don't need 20 minutes of dictation for a succinct discharge summary. So as Tom indicated, we do have the clinical documentation improvement team, and we have two RNs working in our department now who are going through audits and sharing that information with physicians and the coders as well.
John Jordan, Byron Family Medical Center. I just have a comment and question for Adam. As you were speaking, it made good sense to me that the most important thing you need at the emergency room is the important info as to why the patient's coming in from us. I'm still at the point where I feel it's courtesy, talk to the person, call in, should be the physician, but when I call in, sometimes it's just triage. Sometimes it's the emergency physician on. While I'm waiting to speak to them, I think, oh, they're probably not going to be on if it's near shift change or whatever. So it made good sense to me that we do need to send a note along. I usually am doing that as the afterthought on the phone or writing it while I'm waiting to talk to someone. I guess one thing that occurred to me that would be a good idea if we had a one-page standard sheet of why is this patient coming in, what are their meds, what's the important past history. I usually send in the CPP and a written note of the day and send along. But I guess my question was going to be, should we, in the current circumstances, maybe three or four physicians on, don't know if they're going to see the patient or the next shift, should we call triage when we send a patient to emerge? I always do, but in hearing you speak, I think the most important thing is that we get the information with the patient, give this to the doctor that sees you. What do you think? Should we call as well? Does it help you guys to let you know that somebody's coming, or does it just kind of take up time now?
So the answer is it depends, but which means it's a good question. Thank you very much. In terms of the two different forms of communication, both verbal and written, I think they serve two different purposes. So the written communication can ask a question, give this a background to help us care for the patient. When the eMERGE doc, or any doc for that matter, is sort of taking that handover, the verbal communication, currently, my impression from talking to my 65 of us, if you include Pete's 85 in the city now, is that it's an opportunity to divert the patient and or give advice on how the patient should come to the hospital. And so often when I hear my colleagues talk to family docs on the phone, it's, well, have you talked to medicine? Have you talked to ortho? Have you talked to so-and-so? And the response is either, no, at last time I called, it took me 4 days to get a hold of somebody, or yes, I did, and they told me to call you. So my personal bias, and I'm saying this sort of as a in the trenches eMERGE physician, is that phone call and your discussion with me is rarely going to serve the purpose that's intended, at least on my end of the phone, to be able to divert that patient so Alan sees him directly. I say all that with a caveat that it happened yesterday. Andrew Serrata called in with a patient Sharon was involved in, and the patient ended up being seen by medicine, probably more by Sharon's work in the background than by anything that I did. So I think the written form is essential. I think, you know, if we can, we need to have what's the question, what do you think's going on with the patient, and what are you hoping can happen with their visit? The verbal, in terms of a warning, we see 200 patients a day, only at Vic, 150 UH, only 5 or 10 of them come in from another physician's office at most. So if you're sure the patient needs to come to eMERGE, it's okay to just send them. I found that the most advice I'm most often giving with a pre-hospital care background, because in my first 5 or 6 years of my career, that's what I did a lot of work with, was call an ambulance. So I don't, not anyone specific in this room, but I get calls, you know, this person's diaphoretic, they're febrile, their blood pressure's 70, and oh yeah, they just jumped in their husband's car to come to the hospital. I say, wait a second, like, call an ambulance, and don't hesitate to do that. That's the kind of patient should use an ambulance. And on the vice versa, people get sent in by ambulances that don't necessarily need it. So really the phone call is two things. Can they go somewhere else? Or go to the same place with a different provider? And two, how should they get to the hospital? I suspect most people in this room, just based on the fact that you're here, are already managing those things quite effectively. So the phone call is courtesy, if you want to do that, and time-consuming. But the written communication is important. And I'm happy to sort of debate that. I know that's not universally agreed amongst my colleagues.
Hi, I'm Ken Lee, I'm a physician at the CMHA in London. I have access to PowerChart in my clinic, and I see a lot of these patients who are these super-duper users of emergency. You know, they're coming like 50 times a year, 60 times a year, and they cost millions of dollars, etc. And I find access to PowerChart really helpful in getting the background as to why these people have come so many times and what issues I need to address to try to keep them out of the eMERGE, and that's part of the initiatives they have there at the CMHA. I'm surprised that not every family physician can get access to PowerChart in the city, because, you know, you do have OLIS and Clinical Connect and all that, and it is hard to locate all the information you need, whereas when I go to PowerChart, I can just look up back 5, 10, 15 years if I need, get psych reports and get a pretty good summary of what's going on. And is there any initiative in the hospital to get PowerChart out to family docs who do not have privileges at the hospital? Because that would be very helpful.
Yeah, I mean, it gets talked about. Obviously, it would be the ideal case scenario. The problem is that the people who make the software, Cerner is one of the largest corporations, and they're about one thing, making money as well as making a good product. And so it's based on licenses and the cost per license. And so currently it's only for people who are hospital affiliated. So I agree, there's a wealth of information and it's only going to get better. I think Clinical Connect for people in the community provides you a look into all of that information that you currently would see. And so I would say that since we've delivered Clinical Connect, you can now see all of the clinical information that you would see if you had direct access to PowerChart. But I agree with you, Ken. I think ideally, the ideal scenario would be to have every family physician in this city or in the community having access to PowerChart. The problem is
current structure, licensing is based on per user.
How much does it cost?
A lot of money. Yeah.
Next question is...
pay about $10 million a year to Cerner for just our maintenance contract for the licenses we own.
So. Leah?
Hi, Leah Mawinney, community family doctor. My question is about access to specialists. So Adam, I'm interested by your comment to say, can we even speak to specialists? Because I often get kind of caught up in the vortex of, if I want to talk to a specialist, I've paged the wrong pediatrician or, you know, the wrong internist, and I need to talk to this person, that person, and it ends up being a half an hour to an hour phone adventure for me. And then they ultimately say, no, everyone has to go through eMERGE. And then I guess this is the same but different, the concept of having kind of same day appointments or soon appointments for specialists. So somebody who I don't think needs to be seen in eMERGE, but I need them to connect with their specialist fairly quickly, or at least me to be able to talk to them on the phone so that I can manage them in the community. So I wonder if you could comment on that.
Thank you very much for raising certainly a hot button issue in the circles that I currently have meetings with. And it all relates to that input part of the framework that I presented, and so not within my control, for lack of a better term. And there is no rule that you can't see a specialist at London Health Sciences Center or St. Joe's or any hospital that I'm aware of without going through eMERGE. That is a practice pattern, a historical thing that some people adhere to. It's a workload issue. I'm in the OR, I'm whatever, let the eMERGE doc, they're my intern type thing, let them see the patient first. So I applaud your efforts for trying to get a hold of people, and I recognize that most of the time, a lot of the time, there's no fruit to that labor. So our, you know, currently in eMERGE, we basically accept our fate and just try and take care of everybody who comes through the door. I think if you still to this day, if you know you've got an x-ray report, the person needs surgery because they got a trimalleolar fracture in their ankle, they're not going to see eMERGE and get a splint and go to clinic a week later, that ortho should still be taking those patients. That being said, I don't want anyone, a family doctor in a busy practice, spending an hour trying to get a hold of somebody in order to get them seen. On the flip side, I know that I may spend an hour or two trying to get a hold of somebody, even once they're in the emergency department and I've taken care of the problem. So that's one of those constraints that we're working on. In terms of rapid access follow-up, we have a very, what I call, large initiative working on closed-loop follow-up to get people seen from the emergency department in a relatively rapid fashion. One of the reasons I believe our admission rates are higher in London is because we often don't have urgent access, our urgent clinics. I tried to book an appointment at UH yesterday, sorry Alan, and the appointment was booked for March 23rd for a lady that I was kind of hesitant to send home and thought if she saw an internist within a couple days, that'd be a reasonable follow-up, and I called the family doc's on vacation. So I ended up, you know, calling in a favor at Vic and getting her seen tomorrow through that clinic. So we're working to get that access so that we can get people seen that quickly. I think we're a long way from having the same sort of service to someone who's not already landed in the emergency department, unfortunately.
Gord?
Actually, if I can make a comment on that too, because my other hat in the hospital is as a, I'm a specialist, I'm a hematologist, so I do field consult calls through the one number service, and actually, I only very occasionally get calls from primary care practitioners. And I actually would encourage you to call for those, because I end up seeing a lot of people in my hematology clinic that probably was kind of just been a phone call, and actually a couple of times when a family doc has called, it's usually been something quite serious that, you know, we initiate an admission directly from the community for. So kind of those are two extremes. But I think that probably the specialist one number service is a little bit underutilized from the community perspective. The vast majority of calls I get are from people outside London or from other specialists. So I think that that's a resource you could use. And now my other hat as a general internist, as Adam mentioned, that is definitely something that we are working hard on, is to make sure that every subspecialty has urgent clinics with you know, 7-day wait times at the most, to make sure that you have that rapid outpatient access that you need.
Thanks. Gort Schachter, a family doctor in the community. I'm also the primary care lead for the Lynn. Those of you who do not know me up there. Probably a question for Tom and Adam, more directed, given that, Tom, I know you're involved with the information system. So where is LHSC at a status for getting the eMERGE electronic? And then in turn, electronically communicating with family physicians that information?
Want to answer that, Adam? Or?
Sure, but I might step on your toes.
No.
yesterday was my goal. And I've said that out loud a few times to Glenn Kearns and the powers that be, including Tom. But the staged IT strategic plan has obviously more factors to consider than what Adam Duclos and the eMERGE docs want. So my understanding is that we're just starting to do the pre-stage planning for clinical documentation, looking at rollout in late 2017, early 2018. And that's based on like a 10-year IT plan. Once we went and were comfortable with computerized physician order entry and prescriptions, or HUGO as it's otherwise known, which we initially as eMERGE revolted against for about 6 months until we fixed it with the help of Tom and some others. Once we got through that first 6 months, wanted to flip right to clinical documentation. There's a lot of hurdles to jump, but hopefully within a year and a half, we'll be on ClinDoc.
Yeah, and I mean, I think it's also, if the notes are dictated, then obviously they're going to be available through Clinical Connect, which is going to be a mechanism for seeing more of the patient experience within the hospital walls. And it's a, how many people have access to Clinical Connect now? Okay. And how many people are using it and relying on it now? It's interesting, you know. I mean, we've had performance issues. I have a call on Friday with the folks there, and there's been performance issues. And I think when people see something like that, they see the power of what it should do, and then it fails, or you get hung, or you get the whirling little waiting sign, and people just say, "I can't wait," even though I know it's going to be valuable information. So we're really pushing them around performance, but the documentation. If it's electronic, if it's housed within Cerner, then it will be pushed out into the Clinical Connect tool so that we'll be able to see that. The big piece is going to be to actually start to consume the records from the primary care provider so that that information is available when patients can access emergency services or specialty services as well. That's a big missing piece right now.
So just one other comment on that. In terms of getting the eMERGE record, which that yellow sheet, which we scrapped, when part of this transformation, we went from a 2-page eMERGE chart that had 4 carbon copies, so 8 pieces of paper done on a dot matrix printer that we couldn't get fixed anymore, to a 2-page or 1-page chart that carbon copies once. And with that, we lost the yellow sheet that no one could read anyway, and we were told multiple times that no value add. But getting that information, like what I'm history physical, SBAR, whatever you want to call it, into Clinical Connect or Cerner is what I'm talking sort of 18 months down the road. And the discussion that needs to happen is every eMERGE visit going to be dictated on, or is it based on scribes, or is it based on a whole litany of options? And I suspect, I'm hoping that the solution will be as various as what is in your offices these days for those that are on an EMR, where not every family doctor is entering information in their electronic patient record the same way. And I don't think I can expect 65 or 85 eMERGE docs to do that either. So imagine the hurdles to cross that you've all hopefully crossed with your EMR or close to crossing, and getting the sort of 80 docs to work the same way or in different ways with the same system.
Folks, I think... just take one more question.
The issue is data standardization. As long as everyone knows there's a way that data needs to be inputted properly, it doesn't matter, I think, the information that's put in how people do it. It's data standardization is the most important.
As long as they have the tools.
Yeah.
Well, that's all part of the ClinDoc project that Adam's referring to, which I think is rather optimistic, saying 12 to 18 months, probably more like 18 to 36 months.
Every challenge is an opportunity.
So I think I appreciate everybody's questions. Great talks by the panel, and great questions from the audience. You can carry on these things when we come to the roving storm sessions, but I think we've used up more than our time, and I think everybody needs a break. So there's coffee and refreshments back here. We'll take a break for 15 minutes, and then we'll start the roving storm sessions and announce how that's going to happen at that time.